Today's episode of The Bitcoin Show is brought to you by usgoldcoins.com, 1-800-HOT-COIN, and Mezi Grill, MEZEGrill.com, and TradeHill.com, and MountGox.com, MTGOX.com. Hello, everybody, and welcome to the Bitcoin Show. Today is Tuesday, July 19th, and we're already up to episode 26. Can you believe it? 26? I mean, well, when you do it every day, that's like not even a month, or a little bit more than a month, I guess. But anyway, every weekday, we're here 2 p.m. Eastern time every day, Monday through Friday, in English language. And now, of course, we added Spanish language every Wednesday at 4 p.m. And now we're in the process of adding something like 7 or maybe 9 new languages for the Bitcoin Show. It's nuts. We've already, we definitely have a launch date of Thursday, the day after tomorrow. 8 a.m. Eastern is the time slot for the French language, Le Bitcoin. Don't you love that? Our hosts for that will be in Paris, live from Paris, and we're going to have as our guests Mark Carpelles and Adam from Mt. Gox. Mark is the owner of Mt. Gox, and of course, he's French, so his native language is French, so he'll be able to speak to you in French. So exciting. And we're adding lots of other languages, like, I don't even know, German, Dutch, Polish, Chinese, Japanese, Portuguese. It goes on and on and on. It's crazy what's happening over here at Only One TV. It's really exciting. And we're so glad that you join us every day, or as much as you can. I know I'm so busy, I don't have time to watch these shows, because sometimes, you know, I miss things and I want to see it again, and I don't even have time. But I try to as often as I can, and I hope you do too. So today we have with us a fantastic guest who has a fantastic service. His name is David Sterry from ExchangeBitcoins.com. It's otherwise known as ExchangeB, but we're going to get into that. Hello, David. Thanks for joining us.
Hi, Bruce. Thanks for having me on.
Okay. And what were you saying about the wall color behind you?
Oh, yeah. Well, I had the wall painted so it would match the studio there.
Mm-hmm.
You just want to make it seamless so people feel like I'm really there with you.
Yeah, exactly. This is just another chair, and this is his head, and that's the wall.
It's actually in the next room, but we have to complete the illusion.
Yes, exactly. It's just an artificial frame. He's actually sitting right here talking to me, as always. If you were in New York, next time you're in New York, you're going to do that. Oh, by the way, are you going to come to New York August 18th to the 30th? Wait. 18th to the 21st, sorry, August 18, 19, 20, and 21 for the world's first Bitcoin conference. We're calling it BitCon 2011. Some people are protesting. They don't like the name BitCon. But anyway, whatever. Get over it. It's short. BitCon 2011, the world's first Bitcoin conference and World Expo NYC 2011, hosted right here in New York City by Only One TVs. Are you going to come for that?
No plans at the moment, but it sounds like a great event.
You gotta come. Everybody's coming. Like, all the key players. I mean, Gavin is gonna be here, and all the guys from all the big sites are gonna be here, and tons of new startups are gonna be here with table space. I mean, we're right on the verge, and I think we're gonna outgrow what we have here as far as space, and we're gonna have to get a dedicated convention center for the at least for Saturday, if not Friday and Saturday's events. Because there's so much going on, and there's a lot of new startups who are going to announce their products and services there. And actually, Al Jazeera English has expressed interest, and also CNN International has expressed interest in covering it and with, you know, live television. So it's going to be a big deal. So I hope you can come for that.
Wow, yeah, it sounds great.
So tell us about ExchangeB. What's the story?
Yeah, well, so ExchangeB is the first U.S. exchange. And, you know, based in the U.S. and form a corporation to support it. And, you know, we start the site with basically a idea for a simpler look, easy to use site, and low rates, to try to optimize the whole Bitcoin buying experience, like a lot of folks.
Okay, now, what's the story with the name? Because I know that we were talking about this, and it's the logo and the ticker name is EXCHB, which I was having trouble pronouncing, but it's
right.
XB. And but that's just the logo and the ticker, the actual domain name is Exchange Bitcoins with an S, exchangebitcoins.com, right?
Right. Exchangebitcoins.com is the first domain that I purchased, and I actually purchased exchb.com also, because I realized that the ticker symbol was something people saw a lot more, I think, than a website name. You know, every time a trade goes by, people see that. So we have both. The issue with Exchange Bitcoins as a name in itself is it's very hard to search for, kind of generic. Mm-hmm. So you end up with a lot of different things popping up.
Okay.
So Exchange B is easier to search for. And if people see the ticker symbol, they can type in the .com. And if they want to go to exchangebitcoins.com, you know, that's what I would actually mention for a URL.
Okay. So you said, okay, Exchange Bitcoins with an S, exchangebitcoins.com for sure works. What was the other domain that you also have?
Oh, just if you just take that and put a .com on it, Exchange B.
Oh, just EXCHB, you mean, or Exchange B?
EXCHB, that's right.
Okay, because that's where I was. Because EXCHB.com is what you're talking about.
That's
okay, because that's not the whole word. Because if I type in ExchangeB.com, that's probably going to take me somewhere else. Who knows what? But all right.
That is a good point. Yes.
Okay, so EXCHB.com or ExchangeBitcoins with an S.com. Either one will take me there. That's okay. Good to know. And you got is that the new logo? That's the new logo.
That's the new logo. We just launched last night. Launched a new look for the site. It's simplified, easier to use, and definitely from the beginning, I always wanted to create as much a financial oriented site as possible.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think we've achieved that look. I mean, it's almost cleaner than a lot of banks that you'll see. We have a very clean look. No, there's no boxes drawn around anything. It's just the information you want and the interface to get the job done.
Okay. Now, and you're U.S. based, right?
That's right. Yeah. So we're in California. My office is in Redwood City, and so that's where people can send checks if they want to send a check or. The other payment methods are available.
Okay. So, all right. So there it is. Oh, wow. Yeah, you did change it today. You can show my screen, Ed, if you want, and bring that up. Let me make it a little bit bigger so they can see. So that's it. EXCHB. We'll leave it up to you to pronounce, but Exchange B is what we call it. But it's EXCHB.com or ExchangeBitcoins.com. And that's the new cleaner look of the new logo. And so you're based in the U.S. and you're based in California, you said.
That's right.
And how long have you been up?
Well, it sounds like I was listening to your saying we're show 26 and you've been around for about a month. We started about the same time.
So wow.
About June 14th, I think, was the first day we opened for trading.
Mm-hmm.
And, of course, over time, we've got more users and more deposits and more volume, and it seems to be growing. You know, it's a volatile thing, volume from day to day, but we're growing overall, and mm-hmm. we're very happy to have just reached on Bitcoin charts top 10, and definitely think, moving up a few more spots is on the radar, and we're going to take it, as far as we can.
Top 10, that's amazing, because this is global. I was reading, somebody told me that the number three, do you know what the number, well, you probably know because you've been looking at it, but who's the number three exchange site? We'll ask the chat room, see if you guys know. The number three exchange site in the world, everybody knows number one and number two, but who's number three? Do you know? You know, David? Who the number three exchange?
I'm going to bring it up.
You're cheating. Google
right.
Cheat.
Polish
yeah.
Currency.
Is what is it?
It's the Polish
site. That's
Polish
right. It's the Polish site. Exactly. We want to get them on the show. If you're watching, call me. Save me the trouble. But yeah, we want to get the Polish site on here because, yeah, that's fascinating, isn't it? A site in Poland that only does the Polish currency is the number three in volume, which is really interesting. So that says a lot. Obviously, we're going to have to do the show in Polish, too. So, but you're U.S.-based, which is very comforting for some people who in the U.S. who really, care about that because we can hunt you down if you take our clients. And so, all right. So tell us about the unique factors with Exchange B. What are the distinguishing features? Obviously, you said you're in the same time zone, well, as the Pacific anyway. At least you're close enough, so we can get, yeah. We can reach you.
Right, right. And we have a phone number also, which is kind of unique amongst any kind of website and with the exchanges. So right now the number goes to voicemail, but I've called people back to get messages, and it's actually been kind of neat talking with my customers and clients and just talking about Bitcoin sometimes. I mean, what a fascinating technology and industry to work in.
You're so right. I mean, that is a feature. And you know, I love that you put that first, because that is a feature that businesses really don't value enough, and that is not only a phone number, but a phone number that reaches a human being, and only a human being, but somebody who actually knows what's going on, like the founder. So you know, the fact that your number is, can I say it out loud?
Oh yeah, you want the 855 number? Sure.
855-EXCHBTC. So it spelled out. It's area code 855-EXCHBTC. So they call that number, they're going to either get you or your voicemail, and you're going to call them back, right?
You got it, yeah. Absolutely. And if they have any questions about the site or deposits or I guess if they just want to chat about Bitcoin sometime, sure.
Yeah, I know, and then that's what happens. They'll call you, and then you chit-chat about Bitcoin all day. I know, and you don't get anything done. I do the same thing. That's why I decided to make a talk show. Exactly. Because I was taking phone calls and talking about Bitcoin all day anyway. But yeah, so that's really, really important. I mean, like I said, that's an undervalued benefit, because in forums and things like that, in my forum signatures, I put my actual phone number. And that's why I have to put my phone in airplane mode, because people will call me during the show. But literally, if you call my number, you're going to get me. You're going to get me, not somebody else. And so I think it's really important to be, transparent if you possibly can. I mean, nothing against anonymity or privacy and all that. That's all good too. But if you don't have a need to be private or secret or whatever you're doing, and you want to have a face out there in a business, and especially in a business like yours, in an exchange site or any kind of a web-based, cloud-based money system, you're basically acting almost like I won't say a bank, but you're definitely a dealer of virtual goods, and you're dealing with money. And so it's really good that, people, the community has to trust you. If they know, they can call a phone number and you answer the phone and you appear on camera, that just says so much. Whether it means anything in reality or not maybe is debatable, but the fact is that people trust people that they can see and hear and speak to, and they can pick up the phone and call them a lot more.
Sure, so, I think that the risk of putting your phone number out there is like overstated.
Oh, totally.
Because you can actually go ahead and put your phone number on a billboard.
Yeah.
You're not going to get 100 calls.
No, I do actually. I put my phone number everywhere. I put my phone number, like I said, I put my phone number on Twitter and forums, and people are like, "Oh my gosh, you shouldn't do that!" Like it's the password to my banking or something. I'm like, my phone number. I mean, remember when your phone was listed in the phone book? I mean, first of all, I have Google Voice, so if you spam me, I'm going to report you, and you're going to be banned from all Google Voice numbers. So it's going to hurt you more than me. And also, I can report you as spam, and I can also block your number so it never rings my phone again. So you're only going to be able to do that once, and so it's really not a problem. I mean, it's actually, I get less spam voicemails, you might call it, or hoax phone calls, than I do spam on email.
Yeah.
And I publish both.
More protective of email now than their phone number.
I know, it's so weird. Like I'll send a little reply all list, to several friends about Bitcoin, and somebody will just go off and just be livid that I exposed it in the to list. And I'm like, well, it's only a group of people interested in Bitcoin. Oh no. They think their email address is more secure than their social security number. It's like, okay, I guess you don't know about filtering email. But anyway, so we digress. So, but the phone number is really important that we can reach you. We know how to track you down when we have a question. Okay, what are the rates? Tell us about the rates.
Yeah, so the rates, I mean, if you go off of, Mt. Gox, their standard rate is 0.65%, and Trade Hill is now, 0.6% standard rate. And then if you get a referral code, you'll be down to 0.54%. So actually, we just start right there, 0.54, make it easy for people. You don't need to have a referral code. But then we are starting something about that. And actually, yeah, we have a referral code just for your show, which is half off, one word, lowercase. So if you type it in, or uppercase, whatever you want, it's not case sensitive. Mm-hmm. But you go to the site and type in half off for the referral code. On sign up, you'll get 50% off for 30 days on the trade fees.
Yeah.
So that's kind of our rate structure, and then, you know, volume discounts available. Obviously, some people trade a lot, want to provide liquidity, and so we kind of deal with individuals on an individual basis there.
Okay. So now, well, to be fair, you know, Mt. Gox has a temporary lowering of their fee to 0.3% until August 9th, and that's kind of, I guess it's to make amends for the inconvenience that people have had with the hack and so on. But they will revert back, they said this morning, to the 0.65%. And then Trade Hill with a referral fee is 0.54. Is that what you said?
Yeah, well, it's if you take 10% off of 0.6, then okay. you'll get 0.54, I believe. So
you're basically starting there. You're giving them the same rate as if you had a referral fee on Trade Hill. Okay.
Yeah, just saving people time, and they still get the same discount.
Okay, cool. So, all right. So rates are one thing, and then what about the volume? You said you're number 10, are you, or in the top 10 somewhere?
Yeah, number 10, the volume's going. I mean, we're probably averaging between like 200 and 400 bitcoins a day in the last few days, but it just seems to be increasing. And, you know, as more people hear about the site and really hear about Bitcoin, mm-hmm. We expect that volume to increase.
Okay. Now, with the, you know, I mentioned here an affiliate program. Now, I don't understand, because if you're already giving them the rate, the same rate as, like, you know, the others with a referral discount, what's the affiliate program going to be about?
So, well, the affiliate program is, I mean, obviously, having people try the site is probably one of the trickiest things. And of course, like, Trade Hill did a great thing with getting all these the codes out there. I mean, it really kind of got their name out in a interesting way. So mm-hmm. for us, this is a way to maybe do that in a little more measured way, you know, where mm-hmm. we'll have affiliates on a case-by-case basis. You know, somebody has a website, or if they kind of really like the site and they want to promote it, then we'll work with them to make an affiliate code that they can give out.
Okay. So they'll have if somebody has a popular website or whatever, they want to have an affiliate program, then they can get some sort of reward back towards them. And then does the end user get a discount if they use that affiliate link or not?
Yeah, right. Yeah. So, I mean, it's negotiable, but okay. You know, a standard deal would be half off 30 days and mm-hmm. and then a percentage back to the affiliate. Okay. So if anyone wants to contact me about that, it's fine. Sure.
Okay. Sounds great. All right. Now, I have to admit, I haven't used ExchangeB yet, but I'm looking at the page now. You can show it on the screen if you want. So it says here, fund your account with Bitcoin, U.S. dollars, Bitcoin and U.S. dollars and or via Dwolla, Popmoney, ING, Direct Person2Person, mail us a check, or by wire transfer. So is that pretty much the five ways to do it?
Those are the ways to do it. Yeah, I mean, there was a thing yesterday that was about, well, you know, Bitcoin exchanges are popping up like daisies, and they noticed that that we offered by check, you know, and some people have sent in checks. I mean, actually, if you're starting fresh, you know, you've never bought any Bitcoin, you don't have a Dwolla account, sending mm-hmm. a check might be the fastest way to be able to buy Bitcoin, or you know, Popmoney too, if people realize they have a Popmoney in their bank. But a check is kind of like easy for people to understand and. Yeah. So we're happy to be able to offer that.
I said this a while back, and it's really refreshing to hear you say that, because, you know, we talked about the Bitcoin Me site and what advice to give people. How do you buy Bitcoin has always been the question. And I said check, because, you know, like I always say, Fred and Marge in Toledo, Ohio, they're familiar, you know, the non-technical people, they're familiar with a check. And one of the, I mean, it's you know, old tech, low tech, but the thing is, one of the things that we, again, it's undervalued, underrated about checks is that at least an old-fashioned regular paper check, once it clears, it clears. It's not reversible after it cleared, normally.
Right.
So under normal circumstances, and that is exactly what's needed when you're buying something like cash.
Yeah, certainly. it's a good way to do it. And you know, some of my first coins that I bought were on Mount Gox by sending a check to the
sending a check there. To Mount Gox. Okay.
Yeah, and you know, that took a little while, but it was efficient. It worked. Right. And, you know, while Dwolla was getting hooked up for me, that also was going at the same time. So I felt like at least I had an opportunity to get in before, you know, just watching everything go by.
Right. And that's one of the most important things about an exchange site, besides the volume and the fees and all that, and trust is the number one thing. But aside from that, is how to get your money in and out conveniently. So check is obviously a great idea, that you can just mail a check and you feel comfortable knowing that, you know, that's an old-fashioned way to do it. Wire transfer, even, I think wire transfers can even be reversed under certain circumstances. One of the things about checks, though, I mean, once it clears, normally it, if it's an old-fashioned paper check, it clears. However, if you use an e-check, they call them e-checks or ACH and things like that, there actually is a chargeback situation. So a merchant accepting an ACH, from what I've read, can have up to a 60-day chargeback liability. So that's a big problem when people think of a check as a check, but a so-called e-check, an ACH, can actually reverse in up to 60 days, just like a PayPal or MasterCard Visa. So there's a lot of risk with taking that, unless you know and trust the person and all that. ING Direct Person2Person is an ING bank feature. If you have an ING online bank account, right?
Right, absolutely. all these banks have their own systems. Like Chase has one, but I guess that one's really not compatible with Bitcoin. it's kind of interesting how many payment systems have to like kind of come together, and the ones that will work with Bitcoin are the irreversible ones.
Right. And when you say Chase is not compatible, you mean Chase doesn't approve of Bitcoin, or it's reversible, or
the way I understand it was reversible.
Oh,
that was the main
that's
issue
a big problem.
With it,
yeah.
Or you know that it was
disputable.
Yeah, something about that. So wow. And then. ACH, you know, I guess Dwolla would have the same issue because they have to, but maybe it's about that relationship you have with your bank and that you're, that seems to be a big deal with the whole Bitcoin world right now is, you know, how to cooperate with banks.
Yeah, exactly. And Dwolla, now, I wondered that too, because I know Dwolla uses an ACH kind of a arrangement with your bank and to attach it, but I don't know. It's some kind of a like PayPal. They identify you as the owner, and somehow they attach themselves into your bank account to make withdrawals and deposits. But I don't know if that's like the same as a traditional ACH, because if it is, it seems like Dwolla would have a chargeback liability. But I don't know how they get around that. That would be. I would love to have the people from Dwolla on sometime, but so far no luck. One thing I did read on the Dwolla blog is, I don't know if you saw this. But actually, they called me when I first signed up for Dwolla. They actually called me the next day to welcome me, which was like, whoa. Speaking of telephone call, you know, being accessible, that was like really cool. PayPal never called me to thank me for joining PayPal. They actually ended up closing my account, seizing all of my money with no explanation twice. Thousands of dollars just stolen from me by PayPal twice.
Wow.
Yeah, because like several years later, I tried it again and I opened another account and I was using it again, and they somehow figured out it was the same person and they closed my account, took all the money. No, I have no real reason why. I have no idea why. But they just took all my money. But then if you Google PayPal, you'll see that 9 out of 10 websites are, you know, having the same types of stories and experiences with PayPal. So obviously, the only thing we recommend doing with PayPal is closing your account as soon as possible and close your bank account if it's attached to it, and just run, you know, with your money. Dwolla now, interestingly though, when they called me the next day, they actually had told me about this thing called FI Sync. And I'm like, what is that? FI is apparently for financial institutions, but this new technology called FI Sync, they said, trust me, when this comes out, it's going to be so slick. And I was reading in the blog, it's out. There's one financial institution in the world that has it implemented already, and I think it's in Des Moines, Iowa, I think, pretty sure. It's a credit union in Des Moines. And I called the credit union that you have to be a resident of that county in Des Moines to open an account there, unfortunately. But it is a prediction of things to come. So if you have an account at this particular financial institution in Des Moines, they have FI Sync with Dwolla. And what that means, for you is that Dwolla works exactly the same way it does now, except you don't have to wait up to a calendar week for the transaction to happen. They call it 2 to 3 business days, which is really like 6 calendar days in my experience. It's instantaneous. It's faster than a bank wire transfer, and it's 25 cents. Now that's brilliant. If that FI sync expands and it goes out to all the big banks, if they sign up for this thing, or even if they don't, if they sign up with enough banks, you know, hell, I'll switch banks to the one that has FI sync. I mean, I don't know about you guys, but I would, because for 25 cents, I'm basically able to send a wire transfer instantly, faster than a wire transfer, with no hassle, just by going to Dwolla.com. Now that's brilliant. If Dwolla can pull that off and they get enough banks to sign up, that's going to be a real game changer for everything. Really, really slick.
So, the thing about Dwolla, unfortunately, is it's just in the U.S., so that's what I keep hearing from people.
Yeah.
You know, Dwolla is great if you're in the U.S., but if you're not in the U.S., you know, we need other ways, so like Liberty Reserve or doing SEPA transfers. So that's obviously something on the radar.
Yes, we are. We try not to be so U.S.-centric to forget the rest of the planet. We're just one little village, and you're right. I have to remember that. Okay, now what's Popmoney? I've never even heard of Popmoney. What's that?
Okay, so Popmoney works pretty simply. If you have a bank account that, if your bank is a member of the Popmoney system, then you basically are sending the money to an email address. And so once somebody gets this message in their email, they go to Popmoney and they sign in with their email address, they confirm that they own the email address, and then they point them to a bank, a routing number and an account number. And then the money will be transferred basically through ACH that way, and it takes, you know, 2 to 3 days for it to get through. But you do have to wait the 2 to 3 days also on that, and your bank has to be a member of the Popmoney system. So in my experience, maybe 1 out of 3 banks were a member of it. But that's a growing system. I think it's, you know, there's just so much stuff going on in payment processing.
Okay, yeah. So it's So let me like recap then. It sounds very much like Dwolla, but the difference is that your bank has to be a member of it, and then is it instantaneous?
It is, the messages come through just like email. I thought it was within 5 or 10 minutes. It is limited in terms of what banks can send Popmoney. So you can go to popmoney.com and check it out. And we have a link on our front page to go to Popmoney and to go to each of the payment, you know, also Ing. But yeah, Popmoney it's something to look at. Maybe it's another option that's more comfortable for some people.
Very cool. Very cool. Yeah. And interesting. Yeah, I hadn't heard of it, but that's a really cool option. And again, that's U.S. only, right? It sounds like.
Yeah.
So if you're outside of the U.S., then how about ING Direct? Is that U.S. only or is that globally?
That one, it's harder to say. I'd have to get back to you on that. I believe I would start with U.S. only, but it's another system like Popmoney, where you can send transfers for free. There's not even like a 25 cent charge, and I believe it's just the ACH system rebranded.
Okay. Oh, it's just like the ACH system rebranded. Interesting. Okay, cool. So for people outside of the U.S., their best bet is still, it sounds like, wiring, either, I guess, mailing a check, which will take forever if you're in Europe.
International wire can be done, or sending a check. Mm-hmm. I mean, I don't know how long a check takes to cross the Pacific or the Atlantic, but it could be within a reasonable amount of time.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I've got a few more questions for you, and then I want to talk about also some recent major media coverage and talk about that briefly too. But first, I think this is a good time to take a quick break and again thank our sponsors who bring us to you. Again, if it weren't for these guys, we wouldn't be here and we wouldn't be able to bring you all the great interviews and the great information that we do. So please contact them, call them up, email them, and thank them for sponsoring Only One TV, all of our programs, and especially the Bitcoin Show, of course. So first, it's U.S. Gold Coins, usgoldcoins.com. If you're in the U.S., the easiest way to reach them is 1-800-HOT-COIN. That's Andy Gauss. As I've mentioned before, he's our money guru of all types of money. Money, world banking, he's a monetary historian, economist. He's an expert in all of those fields, and his business is actually selling rare U.S. gold and silver coins as an investment. They're rare. They refer to it as numismatic, gold and silver coins. They hold their value two ways. One, because of the value of the gold and silver, but also because of the fact that the coins themselves are rare and collectible. So he'll help you make the right investment and diversify your investment so you don't hold everything in Bitcoin, and definitely not in the U.S. dollar or the euro or anything like that. But anyway, he's speaking of phone numbers and being totally accessible, you can call him up and ask him any question you want. You know, some ladies, or actually a friend of mine is who it was, said that, you know, he was facing foreclosure and he wanted to know what to do. And I had heard Andy talking about something on one of his shows. And I asked Andy and he said, yeah, just tell him to call me up. You know, he's absolutely like that. Just call me up and ask me any question you want. Totally accessible, just like you and I are, David. But call it 1-800-HOT-COIN in the U.S. and just ask for Andy. He's brilliant and he's a sponsor and he's bringing his show. He has a very, very popular national radio show called The Real World of Money with Andy Gauss and Patrick Timpone, and they're bringing it here to Only One TV, to our network, every Wednesday morning at 10 a.m. Eastern. So that's we're really excited about that. But phenomenal guy, and I absolutely endorse him 1,000%, totally trustworthy as well. But that's Andy Gauss, usgoldcoins.com, 1-800-HOT-COIN. When you speak to him, be sure and thank him for bringing you the Bitcoin show. And, of course, Mezzi Grill. Everybody knows Mezzi Grill, our favorite food around here. You know, everybody's like, I know, why don't we have Mezzi Grill cater this and that? They love the food. It's our favorite place. They have, you know, organic as possible, locally grown, you know, really, really fresh and healthy food. It's Mediterranean food and awesome flavor. The reason we discovered them is because it's one of our favorite restaurants that Ed and I go to all the time. And that's, of course, we met the owner and hanging out with me, you're going to learn about Bitcoin. So needless to say, they're the world's first restaurant to accept Bitcoin, and they're really happy about that. So ask for Marwan there when you go into Mezzi Grill. If you're ever in New York or even passing through, it's only like 2 or 3 blocks south of Columbus Circle, but it's MEZEGrill.com. You can check out their menu and you'll see what I mean. Delicious, delicious food. So we thank them. And TradeHill.com, of course. TradeHill is the exchange site for buying Bitcoin online, one of several. The more the merrier, we all agree, I think, in the Bitcoin community. TradeHill.com are the new guys, and they have lots of ways to get your money in and out, and of course, you'll get 10% off your trade fees for life if you use the Bitcoin referral code TH-R141. We thank TradeHill for sticking in there and supporting the Bitcoin show, bringing us to you. Be sure and contact them and thank them. And Mt. Gox, everybody knows, the largest exchange site on the internet, again, to buy and sell Bitcoins online from the comfort of your own home, your own internet, mtgox.com. Everybody knows Mt. Gox. They've been around forever. They've got the vast majority of the market share. They have been hacked recently, but they're back. They're resilient. With new resolve for increased security, and we just did a show this morning about that, so make sure you check that episode out about their increased, what do you call it, two-factor authentication and so on. So mtgox.com, be sure and thank them. You know, just send them a quick email and say thank you for support. All of these guys, send them a quick email and say thank you for sponsoring the Bitcoin show and bringing it to us. Because really, we wouldn't be here. We wouldn't be here without their support. And I think that everybody agrees that the more the merrier when it comes to exchange sites. The more exchange sites, the better for the community, for the Bitcoin community. Because nobody wants a single point of failure. Nobody wants the whole entire burden on one. So I think we're really happy. Everybody in the Bitcoin world is happy that to see more and more exchange sites springing up. Would you agree with that, David?
Absolutely, yeah. I mean, when I was first starting, I remember reading posts that were saying, Mt. Gox was having a DDoS attack at that time. And they're going, well, how can we be so reliant on one? Since then, I mean, things have changed so much, so it's a very good thing. I think it helps us just build that foundation for Bitcoin to jump off from.
Right, exactly. They're just it's amazing what's happened since then. They're springing up like weeds everywhere, all kinds of different exchange sites. But it's really, really good because obviously, you know, healthy competition is healthy in general. And, you know, everybody learns from each other's experiences, good and bad and so forth, and competing on features and all that stuff. It's just very, very good thing for the community. It's kind of like open source software competing with each other. It's a healthy, vibrant, positive, good-feeling kind of competition that, yes, we're competing, but we're really all in it for one thing, and that is Bitcoin. We really want Bitcoin. You know, everybody wants that to thrive because, I mean, let's face it, if Bitcoin does well, we all do well. Everybody in you know, every exchange site, every merchant, everybody who has, you know, the smallest fraction of a Bitcoin is going to be very happy if Bitcoin succeeds. That's why we're involved in Bitcoin. So yeah, that's the number one goal altogether. So, you know, healthy competition is just good fun.
Yeah, it's so great to see, like, also the Mezzy Grill story is so great because it shows people that, yes, you can use Bitcoin in your daily life. And, like, right now, so many people, they just really lack the experience of using Bitcoin, just like they used cash 1,000 times. That's what really why they're comfortable with it.
Right.
And so when Bitcoin reaches that same point, when people start using those QR codes and start paying for stuff that way, and it'll be like, what's this cash thing? Why would we use that?
Exactly, exactly. And on this morning show, Mark and Adam from Mt. Gox were demonstrating this QR code payment voucher system and this new point of sale system they're developing. But lots and lots of people are creating all kinds of new point of sale solutions. It's really exciting. And, you know, I mean, you know, they may be battling it out to see which one, you know, really takes hold, but it doesn't matter. But by the way, that's why the Bitcoin conference and expo is going to be so cool, because all these guys, there are people flying in from China and Central South America and Australia, from all over the world, and they're going to have all their products and services here, hopefully all functioning and on display. All sorts of things like that. So they'll be able to demonstrate, you know, so hopefully apps and software and cash registers and all sorts of things that are designed to accept Bitcoin. It's going to be so much fun. You got to make sure you register. It's bitcoinconference.com, by the way. So make sure you check that out, bitcoinconference.com. All the details will be up actually like within the next 24 hours. We're firming up the entire calendar, schedule, speakers, hotels, and all that stuff. And you'll actually be able to register online for the conference and for a vendor table if you want to buy a vendor table. And of course, only with Bitcoin. If you don't have Bitcoin, then, you know, call me up. I know a guy that sells Bitcoin out in California. But no, we know a couple people who sell Bitcoin. So if you don't have any Bitcoins, call me up. But we only accept Bitcoins for the conference. Ed was like, you know, we can use this thing and it accepts PayPal. I'm like, no, absolutely not. We are not accepting PayPal for the Bitcoin conference. That would be like sacrilegious. No. So so anyway, I wanted to take a few minutes while we have a little bit of time and look at some of the mass media coverage of Bitcoin that's just happened recently. And it actually is kind of like along the lines of what you were talking about using Bitcoin in your daily life.
Welcome back. Imagine being able to pay for something without having to use cash or cards, without having to hand over any personal information, even without having to adhere to the rules of a bank or, how about this, even a government. Well, there is a way you can do just that. It's called Bitcoin, an online currency that's taking the world by storm. Let's see if we can explain this here before we see a full report. This is looking at the rapid growth of the company. It's got more than $100 million within its coffers. Bitcoin is the only just coming to the attention of the wider public, but it's had massive growth since it was launched. Look at that, reserves of since 2009. Estimates put that value already, as I noted, at $100 million. There are no central banks and no governments involved here. Anyone who wants to trade in Bitcoins has to mine them using highly complicated computer software that carries out intense calculations, but the currency is very vulnerable, as you can see here. Two hacking attacks in June alone. This is the vulnerability, and it's not regulated by a central bank, so it's raising a lot of questions. But despite all that and the problems, Bitcoin seems to be taking off. But can this virtual currency really become real world tender? Felicia Taylor has that story.
Okay, that's the introduction. The video you just saw there, that's the introduction from CNN here in the United States. So you get a really good idea of the kind of reporting and coverage that we Americans are exposed to, so you'll have a good idea of the, you know, how we get our information, at least on the mainstream media. So what that was, but and by the way, sorry for the quality of the video. It was actually, I think it was Marwan's iPhone video recording his TV. But anyway, he grabbed this, and this is CNN America. I'm pretty sure that's the regular CNN. And then, but this is kind of like the prequel to the actual CNN International piece that happened after that. But as you can see, I just had to show that. It's only like a minute long. But if you listen carefully, he starts out, I think it's just hysterical. He starts out and he says, okay, let's see, if this is quotes, what he's saying in that video, right? He says, let's see if we can explain this to you before we do a full report, okay? These are little outtakes. He goes, just look at the rapid growth of the company. He's talking about the Bitcoin company, you know. It's got more than $100 million in its coffers. Reserves of, since 2009, estimates put that value already, as I noted, at $100 million. And he goes, later he goes, anyone who wants to trade in Bitcoin has to mine them using highly complicated computer software that carries out intense calculations. So anyone, did you know that? Anyone who wants to trade in Bitcoins has to mine them.
I don't know what I've been doing.
Right, I know. Like, I have never mined one. All right, so then he goes, well, actually, in the early days I did. But anyway, then the next quote he says on the final screen, he goes, but the currency is very vulnerable, as you can see here. And he points to this big graph that says vulnerable. And he says, two hacking attacks in June alone. This is the vulnerability, he says. And it's not regulated by a central bank, so it's raising a lot of questions. But despite all that, blah, 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 he goes into the next story. So show that sequence again, and listen really carefully to the information we are fed. Listen to this.
Welcome back. Imagine being able to pay for something without having to use cash or cards, without having to hand over any personal information, even without having to adhere to the rules of a bank, or how about this, even a government. Well, there is a way you can do just that. It's called Bitcoin, an online currency that's taking the world by storm. Let's see if we can explain this here before we see a full report. This is looking at the rapid growth of the company. It's got more than $100 million within its coffers. Bitcoin is the only just coming to the attention of the wider public, but it's had massive growth since it was launched. Look at that, reserves of since 2009. Estimates put that value already, as I noted, at $100 million. There are no central banks and no governments involved here. Anyone who wants to trade in bitcoins has to mine them using highly complicated computer software that carries out intense calculations. But the currency is very vulnerable, as you can see here. Two hacking attacks in June alone. This is the vulnerability, and it's not regulated by a central bank, so it's raising a lot of questions. But despite all that and the problems, Bitcoin seems to be taking off. But can this virtual currency really become real world tender? Felicia Taylor.
Oh my God, we had to play that video over and over again, and we were laughing so hard. I just couldn't believe it. Look at the rapid growth of this Bitcoin company. We got to buy some stock in this Bitcoin company. Look, it's got $100 million in its coffers, and the only way to use them is to mine them with it. But it's very vulnerable, he says. There's two hacking attacks alone in June. Anyway, it's just crazy. It's crazy. So, you know, as I say, lazy journalism. But on the other hand, that was CNN US, I'm pretty sure. But Felicia Taylor of CNN International did a great job. And I really think they did a fantastic job. And it's not just because I'm in the thing. But she really did. She did a really good objective overview of Bitcoin and where it's coming from, which is kind of rare. I mean, you see so many of these that they're obviously biased. They seem like they're told, you know, do a story about Bitcoin and make Bitcoin look bad. You know, and then they're like, okay, what's a Bitcoin? And then they start there.
They even used that video and kind of, you know, mimic some of the stuff that was said on the video. So that video is so great.
Yeah,
The whole segment I thought was nice. And it's nice not to have to like, diffuse some misinformation.
Exactly. So let's roll that one. This is CNN International, what the rest of the world gets to see that we don't always get to see in the U.S. So let's roll that one.
It's the middle of the lunch rush at Mezza Grill in Midtown Manhattan.
Yes.
Cold hard cash is being exchanged.
There you go. 80 cents is your change.
But so is a virtual kind of currency called Bitcoin. The payment takes place entirely over the internet via anonymous encrypted code. this one being made with a mobile device.
7035 bitcoins.
There are more than 6.5 million bitcoins in circulation right now. Users can purchase everything from clothing to professional services to tech gadgets. Meza Grill is one of the few brick-and-mortar businesses accepting bitcoins. Owner Marwan Salem says he began taking them in April and gets a handful of customers paying with them each day.
We've had a lot of customers who have come through just for that reason, because they've said, you know, they've heard through the grapevine or through the internet that we take bitcoins.
Salem started accepting bitcoins after learning about them from customer Bruce Wagner, an IT expert.
I use it as much as I can. A lot of people are just getting into it to invest, but I use it, obviously, have lunch with it here. We try and support all the merchants who accept Bitcoin.
Bitcoin is peer-to-peer. Money passes directly from user to user without any bank or government involvement. Wired Magazine's Jason Tan says that absence of regulation is one of the reasons why Bitcoin is so attractive to some.
Some of the libertarian arguments that are coming out these days are about, you know, worried about the fact that the Fed has so much control over monetary policy. And at any moment, the Fed can decide to print a ton of money, and all of a sudden, then you've got inflation. Other people just, it's less of an economic argument, it's more of an ideological argument that, you know, the federal government should not have that kind of control over my assets.
And for others, it's an investment opportunity, or simply something cool they want to try out. Here's how it works. Users download Bitcoin software, which acts as a wallet. They then fill the virtual wallet with virtual Bitcoins, acquiring them through a process called mining, a series of complex mathematical calculations. Or they get them from a Bitcoin currency exchange, which is the more popular method. The way Bitcoins get their value is similar to the way stocks get their value. Bitcoin buyers drive the value up, sellers drive it down.
Recent history is rife with examples of people who've tried to build alternative currencies. Frankly, they never end well. Bitcoin is different in that it really is a separate parallel currency that was created out of nothing. I mean, you know, it arose to something like $180 million worth of value they created out of thin air.
Critics have said because transactions are, for the most part, anonymous, Bitcoin makes it easy to sell illegal drugs or launder money over the internet. And some people say it amounts to a Ponzi scheme. But others say Bitcoin is legit and could pave the way for future digital currencies, one click at a time. Felicia Taylor, CNN, New York.
What do you got today?
Wow. So yeah, Felicia Taylor did a great job, I think, at CNN there. And, you know, one of the things I wish they didn't, that they kind of downplayed a little bit is the mining. I mean, Stefan did a fantastic job with the We Use Coins video. I mean, you know, he did a great job. I think it's a little bit unfortunate that it emphasizes mining so much. I mean, it's a fascinating little twist on the Bitcoin story, but mining, for the most part, is not really relevant to the average user anymore. But and it confuses people a bit. But aside from that, I think, you know, the video is fantastic, and Felicia Taylor at CNN International did a really good job. Did you notice, by the way, Wired Magazine? Every one of these, it seems like every one of these major ones, they always get somebody from Wired Magazine. And I've been trying to get this one guy to come on the show, but on CNN International, which is the one we just saw, Jason Tan from Wired Magazine gets it right. I mean, I think he does a very good job of explaining what it is and why it is and why people are behind it and all that. However, if you saw that Al Jazeera English one, there's a guy named John Abel from Wired.com. I don't know if that's Wired Magazine or just the blogger or whatever, but there's a guy named John Abel from Wired.com, and he totally gets it wrong. Did you hear that one, David?
No, I didn't hear that. I mean, okay. I've definitely seen a varying amount of coverage for Bitcoin.
Yeah.
Well,
if you go to YouTube and just do Al Jazeera English Bitcoin, I think you'll find it. But John Abel said, pardon me, this is a quote from him, okay? This is all he said. This is his entire little interview. They've got John Abel, Wired.com. He says, I can't think of a really good legitimate reason that anybody would be using bitcoins to buy milk and eggs and things like that. It's a crazy, wacky currency. That's it. That's all he said. That's why I'm like dying to get him on as a guest. So far, the answer is no. But anyway, to answer John Abel's concerns about buying milk and eggs with Bitcoin, I wanted to bring up a couple points. There's bitmunchies.com. Check it out. You got that on the lower there. Bitmunchies.com. Have you seen that, David?
That's pretty.
Yeah,
neat.
Yeah, I mean, you can buy all kinds of groceries and snacky poos, everything a geek would want. You know, you can just do the Twinkies and Coke diet, absolutely anything you could possibly want to munch on. I wish they delivered in 10 minutes. If they were in Manhattan, they would. But anyway, bitmunchies.com, you can buy all sorts of groceries, not just munchies. I mean, they've got everything. All right, bitmunchies.com. And then, of course, we had recently as a guest bitcoinworldmarket.com, which is a recent new launch, new startup. But bitcoinworldmarket.com sells absolutely everything, all sorts of, you know, remote-controlled helicopters and you name it from A to Z. But one of the things they sell is groceries. They've got tons and tons of, you know, of prepackaged groceries and foods. So another place, another Bitcoin grocery store. And then, of course, last but not least, you've got Bitcoin, the number 2cc.com, Bitcoin2cc.com, which a lot of people really love because you can actually just take your Bitcoins and buy a virtual Visa or MasterCard and then shop anywhere. Anywhere that Visa or MasterCard is accepted. So you can probably use your Peapod or basically any restaurant or any store that sells food or groceries. You can use a Visa that accepts Visa or MasterCard. You can use your Bitcoin indirectly that way. And, yeah. You know, now, what were you going to say? Go ahead.
Oh, does Mezzy Grill uses some system to do their, how do they do their payment processing?
You know, I set them up because, you know, I'm all about making it quick and dirty and easy. And so literally what we did is I said, go to mybitcoin.com and click sign up. So they have a mybitcoin.com address, and that's what he's using for the moment. But, they're going to migrate to something, you know, a little bit more robust and, more under his own control as opposed to a web-based, you know, an entirely web-based service. But right now it's simply mybitcoin.com. You got an address, you make a QR code, and you're done. I mean, it's just like unbelievably simple. Speaking of Mezzy Grill, there are three restaurants now in New York City that I know of. There may be more by the time this goes out, but who accept Bitcoin. Mezzy Grill, MezzyGrill.com, our sponsor, of course, is the first one. Now, the second one in New York City, which is also the first one in Brooklyn, is ocrepes.com, the letter O-CREPES.com. They're not a sponsor yet, but they will be. And they have, it looks like fantastic crepes. They were on a previous episode as well. And now I just, yesterday, or was it the day of yesterday? Yesterday, I convinced one of our favorite restaurants in town that's like right in our little neighborhood called Hudson Eatery. A lot of celebrities actually eat there. Like us, we eat there. So anyway, but it's called Hudson Eatery, H-U-D-S-O-N. EATERY. I think you have to do the www.hudsoneatery.com to check it out, but it's right here in Hell's Kitchen as well. And they've said, I mean, they've known about Bitcoin, you know, like all the restaurants that we go to all the time, you know, we become friends with the owners, and they've known about Bitcoin for quite a while, but only thought of it as an investment. But I'm like, no, you should accept it in the restaurant. And they're like, okay. And so I set them up, and now they accept Bitcoin. So now, you know, the Bitcoin conference, of course, we're going to have our lunches at Mezzy Grill and our dinners and cocktails at Hudson Eatery and then, you know, our breakfast crepes at O'Crepes and all that. Everybody's going to want to visit all the Bitcoin, you know, merchants, of course. Where else would we eat?
Sure, like a Bitcoin bus or something like that.
Absolutely, yeah, the Bitcoin bus. That's what we should do. We have to do that. Get a great big bus and paint a big Bitcoin on it.
I need to get some businesses hooked up in the Bay Area here so we can do our own Bitcoin bus over here too.
We totally have to do that. And you know, it's so easy. You know, people think that it's like, how did you get them to agree? And it's like, I told them. You know, it's like when you tell somebody, look, okay, Mezzy Grill bought an ad on our show. And, you know, embarrassed to say how little they paid. And meanwhile, they've got Reuters and NPR. You got Business Week, you know, Fortune, Forbes, yeah. CNN, Al Jazeera English. I mean, all these people shooting. I mean, they've got more publicity than they could have ever dreamed of. And, okay, on top of that, this is what I told the guys at Hudson Eatery, you know, this story. And I said, and what's Bitcoin? Well, it's just like cash. Gotta love that. There's the transaction fees are zero. There's no such thing as a chargeback. and it's instantaneous. And what's the downside? Can't really think of one. You know, they're like, okay, let's do it. Show me how. And then you literally show them how. I mean, if you want to make it super easy, just mybitcoin.com. Or, you know, if you want to get a little bit more sophisticated, you can, you know, show them some more sophisticated app or tool that they can use on their Android phone or even their, I don't know. We're hoping that someday Steve Jobs will allow an iPhone app that does this, but Android for sure will. But it's not so hard. Just ask any restaurant, anybody you do business with, if it's a grocery store or a gift shop or whatever it is, you'll be surprised that merchants will be going, yeah, sure. And you'll get new business. You'll get people coming here specifically because you take Bitcoin. And that's exactly what's happening.
Yeah, that's the new technology. They can jump on and get some business out of it. I mean, that's really the threshold that Bitcoin has to cross too.
Yeah. One more question I've got for Exchange B for you, David, is, are you going to do, or do you already have anything for merchants, for like merchant services? Are you wanting to get into that?
Well, yeah, I mean, we see that, you know, people might think this is going to be something over the next few years that's going to take hold. But I think with some of our future products, we have an opportunity to roll something out much sooner than that. So we're looking forward to taking it to the merchant side.
Okay, cool. But right now, do you have any facility for if I have an account on Exchange B, can I send dollars or bitcoins to another account holder on Exchange B, or no? It's just for buying and selling Bitcoin.
Not yet. So far, yeah, just buying and selling bitcoins.
Okay.
But definitely a feature that we know is important. So.
Well, there's nothing wrong with having a focus and knowing the one thing you do best. Like Google search, you know, it's just they do one thing and they do it the best, you know.
Yeah.
Whatever it may be.
Definitely set the foundation here. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. That's fantastic. So any parting words you want to leave the public with about Exchange B? Or Bitcoin in general?
I want to thank everybody for watching, and thank you, Bruce, for having me on. And if anybody has any questions or anything, you feel free to check out the site and give me a call or email. It's all good.
Awesome. Thank you. David Sterry from ExchangeBitcoins.com, which is ExchangeB for short, but it's ExchangeBitcoins.com to find it. And his phone number, I'm going to say it again, 855-EXCHBTC. Give him a call and bug him. He will talk Bitcoin with you all day, just like me. We'll make a conference call. Well, thank you, David, for joining us. It was really fun, as
My
always.
Pleasure.
All right. Take care.
Thank you.
And thanks, you guys. We'll see you tomorrow. 2 p.m. Eastern, don't miss it. And Thursday morning, 8 a.m. in French, if you speak French. Take care. See you then.